what we are going to talk about, I title it From the Holy into the Most Holy. Amen? From the Holy into the Most Holy. Why from the Holy into the Most Holy? It's because we know that Jesus is coming soon. Amen? And when you look at Revelation, the Bible says very well that Revelation 11 say, then I was given a measuring stick and I was told, go and measure the temple and God of God and the altar and count the number of the worshippers. Hallelujah. But do not measure the outer courtyard, for it has been turned over to the nation. Amen. So every Christian must do everything they can do to be holy. And but now when you are in the holy, you need to press on to be in the most holy. Then when Jesus comes, you are among the people to go. Two, you may be saved when you are born, when you are born again, but you just end up in paradise. Hallelujah. Because in heaven as well, we have three places. Hallelujah. We have those who reach the most holy, who are on the throne, who has throne, and the throne are around the throne of the Lord. And then these are people who are being the co-heir and the co-leaders who are going to live in the millennium. We understand. But it's not everybody who is going to come back and live in the millennium. Only those who reach who actually will be transfigured, who have that new body, amen, that will make it. But that's not our objective today. But I just will tell you, this is the target. So we are, it's not just coming to church to say, oh, I'm a Christian. No. Even in Christianity, there is greatness. Amen. I would say in life right now, when we come on earth, somebody say, I have a baby, and you are born. It's like you are successful. It's good. You have to grow. Have whatever nationality you have. In the society as well, there are some great positions in the society that we look for. It's the same thing in Christianity. This is what we want everybody to pursue, or God wants everyone to pursue. Amen? So, I would say meaningful life starts from the holy, and transfiguration starts from the most holy. Meaningful life. What do I call meaningful life? You may manifest many spiritual gifts, but as far as you are not sharing what pleases God with Him, amen. We are out court, regardless of the number of people that follow us. Hallelujah. Regardless of the people, okay, let me put it, who say meaningless? Solomon. Amen? Okay. So if you say meaningless or meaningless, you see the life Solomon lived by the end. That life was not a holy life. We agree. Hallelujah. But Solomon had the gift of wisdom. But still, he didn't make it to the holy. So I want to point this out to us so we can understand this very well. And when we understand this, can help us. Hallelujah. But now, if you can grow, you are in the moon, what I say, meaningful life. So God will come and share things that is meaningful to God to you. Like God will open your eyes, or God will be revealing things to you. When what He reveals to you, He knows in your heart and your mind that you know you have it, what do you call it? The transformed mind, amen? Your mind have changed. As your mind have changed, so you know what pleases God. As you know what pleases God, when He reveals it to you, you know that you are going to pray. Because He needs a man to pray on earth for things to happen. Hallelujah. Exodus 24, 9 to 10. He said, then they climbed the mountain, Moses and Aaron, Nadab, Abihu, and the 70 of the elders of Israel, and they saw the God of Israel, and He was standing on the pavement of something like a sapphire, pure and clear blue sky. Amen? Okay, this version is from the Bible, the Message. Amen? Why did I bring this? When you notice, we know that Moses lives in the most holy. And you used to go there regularly. But all the others not. Hallelujah. But the way they were selected. So we know that they were at least holy. Okay? To the point that they can stand. Amen? Amen? So when I say a meaningful life, my meaningful life is an internal vision and audible interactions with the Lord where your response are what he expects from you. Amen? What I'm talking about, maybe you don't experience it, but know that it do exist. What I mean is that, okay, today, most of us, or some of us, we have dreams every morning before we wake up, isn't it? But now, some people as well, it's not just dream they have visitations. Or they go into trance, and they have things like that. Amen? They have spiritual manifestations. But now what they see lead them to say something. Amen? And these people are saying meaning, they live a meaningful life. What I say meaningful is meaningful in the standard of God, not meaningful in our standard. Hallelujah? So, I'll say this only happens when we reach the holy and maintain ourselves in the holy. Amen? Here God visits us every day and share with us what matter to him and expects us to pray for him to be able to ask or fix the situation on earth. He shares his plan and wonders as well with you if you are in the holy. Amen? But how do we reach the holy? This is the most important. How do we reach the holy? It's important that we understand how we reach the holy. Hallelujah. I'll tell you that you must be able to be doing all of that you know that God is asking you to do. Okay? Let me give you these tips. If God asks you to do something and you are not able to do it, please, it's important that you start asking God, please help me, and he will help you. He can never ask you something to do, and he knows that very well that you know what he's asking you to do, and you don't want, and you cannot do it, and you ask him help, he will not help you. He will help you. Amen? Ask him earnestly, and he will help you. Hallelujah? So, two, I'll say, you must be able to stop all God is asking you to stop. Because there are things you have been doing that does not please God, or maybe it's not bad itself, but it's not good for you. According to your calling, it's not good for you. Amen? Okay. Now, this is the tough one. Your thoughts must be pure as well as your actions. Your thoughts must be pure as well as your actions. Okay? If you remember in Romans 12, Paul told us, and so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your body to God because of all he has done for you. Let it be a living what? A holy sacrifice. The kind that he will find acceptable. This is truly a way to worship him. Don't copy the behavior and custom of this world, but let God transform you into a new person. And this is very, very important. Into a new person by changing the way you think. So your thoughts must be as pure as your action. But now the key I want to tell you is that you need to start not watching yourself, but watching your thoughts. Because whatever doesn't come to your mind will never come into your action. So you have to be judging. So as you study the Bible, you are reading the Bible or whatever books you are reading, and the Holy Spirit is ministering to you. Whatever the Holy Spirit is ministering to you, you say, God, you stop. As you read it, you stop. Say, Father, give me this. I want this. Give me this. I want this. Until, but now, whenever something opposite is about to come to your mind, say, Father, no, no, no. But you are not saying that no audibly for everybody to know around you, but inside you say no. Then you are maintaining yourself in that holy. So there is no way you will not be having regular encounters. Two, there are something God is asking you to do. Like one scripture that says what the one who ought to do good but is not doing it is sinning. So you see, you have an opportunity. You are going somewhere. You know that somebody needs something there. You pick it, you go and give it to him. Because that one, you are doing good. But you are just saying, oh, what is he going to say? What is he going to say? What you want to do is, immediately you remember that verse. The one who ought to do good is not good. So the Holy Spirit speaks to you. You come and pick the things and give to the person. So what he asking you to do, inside, you are making sure you are doing it. When he asking you to stop, inside, as soon as he want to come, you reject it. Then your thoughts will be as well pure as your action. Because if you don't judge your thoughts, because most of the time what happens is that sometimes somebody talking to inside there, look at his face. Finish. You'll be saying a lot of things. That thought is not pure. And tomorrow you are praying, you say God is not answering because you are not holy. God loved that person. But where we are going, God wants you to reach a level that he can share his burdens with you. Hallelujah. Let me show you this. In Romans 14, verse 1 says, accept other believers who are weak in faith and don't argue with them about what they think is right or wrong. Accept other believers. Amen? Who are weak in faith. So what I'm going to say is that you may think you know something better than somebody. So that area, maybe the person is weak. But accept him. Because you are not born, when you are born, you didn't know what you know today. So give time to everybody to grow. Hallelujah. Amen? I believe in school, what happened is that some people will go and read this subject. When they finish, they start another one. So maybe while you are reading this, he is reading something else. Hallelujah. So it's important that our thoughts must be pure. If it's not pure, it's not good. Amen? So, you must be... Yeah, your thoughts must be pure as well as your action. Sinful thoughts may flash into your mind, but they are rejected as soon as they come. I'm talking about the holy. They are rejected as they come. I want to tell you, you are blessed to hear this. Amen? Only those who are in the holy are effective soldiers of the kingdom on earth. Why? Because they know what God wants. They will know what God likes. They know what is of the devil. They know what God hates. So as soon as the situation, God share the situation with them, they know what to do, what to pray. Hallelujah. And one point that's very, very important, they are not selfish. That's why the Bible tells us in Psalm 110, verse 3, it says, your people will offer themselves willingly to participate in your battles, in the day of your power, in a splendor of holiness. In a splendor of holiness. Hallelujah. Most of the time, what's happening to the majority of the Christians today, what happened to us is that we are on the court. We are not in the holy. So we are praying the same prayer. We are asking this. We are asking, but things are not changing because what? God is waiting for us to change one thing. Or two, or three. Amen? So, when you are in the holy, So your thought and this must be pure. But now, wrong thoughts may flash, but when they flash, you have to push it away. But now, how do you reach the most holy? How do you reach the most holy? I want to tell you that to reach the most holy, the first thing is that you must be able to speak less. I'm telling you, to speak less. I'll prove it to you. Amen? I will say straight away, that is the most difficult step in our generation. To reach the most holy is the most difficult because we are distracted. I'm telling you, even on the TV, you have opportunity. What you are just watching on the TV, you have opportunity to criticize somebody. Only on the TV or even in the movie, you have opportunity to criticize someone in the movie. So it's not easy. But I believe that God is able. If we trust that God and we are ready to pay every price for him. And one thing I want to tell you is this. If you remember, Jesus did what? He went on the cross. He didn't like it. But why did he say, take your cross daily? Because we remember we like things that are easy. So when they tell you, Jesus did this for you, Jesus did this for you, we are happy. But there are some level you have to do your own. You have to do your own. That is the truth. Amen? So, the way you think must become the way God thinks. When you want to greet the most holy. The way you think must become God or the way God thinks. But let me tell you this, yeah? You don't reach the most holy and change there. You must change before you reach the most holy. I don't know if you are getting what I'm saying. Amen? Whatever wrong or wickedness you see people doing or saying, you must be able to remember that God did not create them to be like that. But is the evil one that had made them like that. Hallelujah. Is the evil one that had made them like that. When you are hurt, you go to the Father. You do nothing to the person. Because you are already on the holy, eh? When you are hurt, you go to the Father. Amen? I know this is not our usual life, but this is what God requires. Okay? You will see wrong around you, but he wants you not to talk against the wrongdoer. Expect to him, God, alone, because he is preparing you for the most holy. If you remember very well, Jesus in the Peter say, 1 Peter 2, 22 to 24 say, he never did one thing wrong. Not one saying said anything amiss. They call him every name in the book and he said nothing back. He suffered in silence, content to let God set things right. He used his servant body to carry our sins on the cross so we could be rid of sin, free to live in the right way. His wounds became our healing. Amen? So once we are established in this new way of living, he moved us into the most holy. What I'm saying is that, let me explain more because it's like you're not getting. So, okay, you remember Moses. He had a great grace. The grace he has for not being able to talk freely. Okay, that's what helped me. Somebody who is not free at this thing, how can he talk too much? He can't talk too much. But when you talk too much, I'm telling you, anybody who talk too much, anybody who talk too much, some of them, you will see some lies in their too much talking. That is true, yeah? Some of them, you will see criticism. But you can't see somebody who talk too much and there's no criticism or no lie. It's not possible. Amen? It's not possible. Amen? So, is what God is asking us to do. So, you change inside completely. Because let me tell you, the body will change. With age, the body changes. Amen? But inside is what God is wanting you to change. Then you see your own contest with God. You see your distance with God. When you see the way you become close, like this guy I'm talking about, Jesus used to live, if he passed away, left, to appear to him, to go to him, like physically, every day for 40 years, 40 good years. I don't know if he left this world at the age of 82 or 80 something anyway. He's over 80. For 40 good years, he will come physically. So it's not just to the people of the Bible, this thing is possible. For us as well. For our generation. And this person did it in our generation. Amen? But the big mistake that we believe in is the grace of the manifestation without the grace of the paying the price. We believe in the grace of manifestation. Say, oh, God bless him. He's doing this. He's having this, having this. But what he's doing before that is coming into manifestation. That one is like we don't want it. If anybody have a grace, what you want is manifesting anything. The first thing you want to know, if you like it, how do you get it? What do you do? How do you live like that? That means he lives a lifestyle I don't live or you don't live. Hallelujah. Somebody may tell me you are a doctor, medical doctor. I'm not a medical doctor. So what's the root? There's a root to everything. Hallelujah. So once we are established in that life where we don't criticize things like that, God must move us into the most holy. Amen? But now in the most holy. Here, you see him physically, like Moses used to. And you feel him as well physically. And he appear to you in different form. Amen? Different forms. And take you in different scene depending on the message he want to give you or share with you. When you hear God being called Adonai, El Shaddai, the way you look as El Shaddai is different from the way he looks at Adonai. When the Father appears every time, whatever message he wants to tell you is the form he takes. Amen? Even including the angel, when they appear to you as well, what they come to do, even the appearance is a message. Hallelujah? So, I can say, in the most holy, you master the true meaning of humility to maintain yourself at that level. I'm going to give the definition of the true meaning of humility. True meaning of humility. Because we have a definition of humility from outside, but we don't have the definition from humility from inside. The definition of humility in inside is seeing value in people regardless of their mistake and behavior. You see value in them. It's a gift. Let's put it this way. You look at God. Look at how sinful we are. But we say he loves us. He loves us for what? Because he sees some value in us. So at any point, whatever the person is doing, God will open your eyes on something because he called God, he called Moses the most humble. Okay, the most humble. And the people of Israel, will be sinning, will be doing things that are wrong. Still, God will be, Moses will be interceding for them. Why? Because Moses was seeing some value in them. Amen. But when you see that value, let me tell you, nobody loves something that's not valuable. So before you say you love somebody, there is something you see as value in the person. Okay? So when they say God loves us, there is a value God sees in that he loves us. But when you say love each other, if you don't see value in somebody, you can't love the person. You must see some greatness in the person or upon the life of the person in order to love the person. Let's just put it this way. When before you walk to somebody, say, I want to marry you, I want to do this with you, I want to spend time with you, do you every time you see something that attracts you, something that, the same thing, you have been created in the image of God, in his likeness. So that's the definition of humility. But anytime you look down on somebody, it's pride. Hallelujah. So whatever anybody is doing, like the whole church or even the carnal people or whatever, because you have the revelation of who is God, you see what life's supposed to be. And you see that it's possible by your God to make him like that. He said, what you would like other to do to you, do it to them. Love your neighbor as yourself. Then you see value in people. As you see value in people, you are interceding for them. Sometimes God will use you to deliver somebody. You don't even need to tell the person that, oh, I've witnessed this, this has been happening, whatever. No. Because you know that at the end of the day, you don't have yourself the capacity to do it. It's God that did it. Amen? So it's important. That's why we must be constantly pleading for people if you want to remain in the most holy. Just check it. Jesus, what the Bible tell about Moses, he was always pleading for people while he was in the most holy. Hallelujah. But what I want to tell you today is that I don't want to talk to you about Moses. I want to talk to you about yourself. That we can do the same thing. If not, God will not require that from us. What he say? Be my imitator. And Paul say what? Be my imitator as he is the imitator of Christ. Amen? Romans 8, verse 34, say what? Who then will condemn us? No one. For Christ Jesus died for us and was raised to life for us. And he is sitting in the place of honor at God's right hand, pleading for us. Why is he pleading for us? Because he had been in the most holy before leaving the earth. So he was doing it on earth. As he go there, he can continue because he's now at the place he has throne next to the throne of the Father. So when you want to have throne around them, you need to reach that level. You don't reach that level here. You can't go there and say, no, I want to reach. No. Hallelujah. And at this level, you know how to wait on God. Sometimes you may sense something that is not right. But you are praying until God shows you something before you open your mouth. Hallelujah. Because sometimes some wrong are allowed by God himself in order to prepare the person better, for the person to learn better. Hallelujah. Amen. So, in the most holy, you are expected to carry his instruction to debtors. Yeah. I say, in the most holy, you are required, amen, or expected to carry his instruction to debtors. Little mistake is a blunder. You remember Moses? What God told him? Go and speak to the rock. But he commits what we call a religious sin. Because before God told him to heal the rock, he hit it, the water came. The second time, God said, go and speak to the rock for the cold water to come. He went and hid the rock. Amen? When you remember David, God told Moses and Aaron in the book of Numbers to count the people. They count the people. So you can't tell me David did not read that book. He read it. Amen? But now David told his commander to go and count the people. What God did? God punished him. It's religious. Hallelujah. So in the most holy, when you reach the most holy, even certain things are there. That's why I tell you, the Bible is there for your knowledge or instruction. No, instruction. How did I say? For you to know. For your instruction, for you to know. But what you require from me specifically is the Holy Spirit. The way I put it simple for us to know is that if somebody is called an evangelist, amen, an evangelist, you can't live a life of pastor. What is required from the pastor is in the Bible. What is required from the evangelist is in the Bible. But you may want to do everything that is in the Bible. First of all, it's impossible. It's impossible to do everything that is here. Hallelujah. There are things some people, God has used some people to do here. I cannot do it. Only God will use me to do it. If God does not call me to use me that way, I will struggle, nothing will happen. I mean, even hearing somebody or seeing somebody manifesting a gift, I want to manifest the same gift. If God does not call you that way, no. But now, how do you know that God calls you to do it? In a dream, at some point, you see yourself doing it. At least once. Then you know that it has been written in your DNA to manifest it. In a vision, you see yourself at least once doing it. Then you know that, you have to pursue this. Because how come God can use you in the dream, the realm of the spirit, to do it if he doesn't call you to do it? But not is because you see somebody doing it. No, because God has used you to do it. Hallelujah. So it is important that we understand this. When we understand this, you see that we live a peaceful life. Amen? Because I don't see on the building side a carpenter fighting to do the electrician job. He may be electrocuted. Hallelujah. Amen? So it is important. In the most holy is to get us. If you remember Elijah, he fell when he started making statement before consulting God. In the whole Israel, there's no one. I was the only one. You should go and anoint Jehu, and you come. Elisha will continue. So that's why you see that some of the things in 1 Kings 19, God told Elijah that he should go and do. Later, Elijah left Elisha that did it. Two, like I'm saying here, your gifts are nothing compared to your fruits. It's the fruits that God look at. The gifts are in your spirit, and the spirit of God is using you to do it. The fruit is what you have done, the part of God you have downloaded, you have adopted, that come into your soul, become your personality. You change it with your carnal manhood or man, what the ability. That's the fruit, to the point that you do, even God has not asked, but yourself you will do it that way. Amen? So it's the fruit that God look at. When you look at it, I say something here one day, I say, if you remember, Elisha carry what? Double portion of what? Elijah. Of anointing of Elijah. Elijah, who carried half of his portion of anointing, was raptured. Elisha, who carried double, was buried. To whom much is given, much is required. So most of the time we are asking a lot. We are asking. Sometimes we don't know what we are asking. That's what James said. I'm not asking you guys to be teachers, because much will be required from you. Hallelujah. But now what we are saying today is that we need to grow the fruit. We need to do, I won't say, I can call it violence, but I can call it, I don't know, dedication, focus, for us to change inside. Amen? But how do you know you change inside? With your communion with God. Your closeness with God. Because when you change with God, when God comes, what he does, first of all, in the beginning, he always tell you, change this, don't do this, change it. You go to God, you have dream, you know, you notice that there is something you are going to do. It's like he's telling you, he's correcting you. Amen? But he reached the time, he doesn't talk to you, he doesn't talk to you about yourself anymore, but he's talking to you about others. Then now you are co-worker. Amen? So we need to know that when you are in the most holy, your word are not your word anymore, but his word. That's why you must be careful what you say. Amen? Then you live no more but him living through you. But now from the most holy into the transfiguration, what happens? When you meet God in the most holy, okay, you see him like this. And we talk about those things like Kazon, Mara, and Makase, the last three. Eyes to see him. When you are look, you have vision all the time. You see him physically, but it's like a glass, spiritual glass between you and him. You see him clearly in 3D, but you don't feel him. Amen? He may speak you here, but you don't feel him. But when you reach Mara, you feel him. But then when you hear Makase, when you feel him, what happens is that there are some energy that comes out of him that start burning you inside. Okay? This one burned Moses till his face changes. Hallelujah. So one part of you will be transfigured. The other one will be transfigured. The other one will be transfigured. Until one day, everything completely transfigured. But why am I saying this? Is because the time of transfiguration has arrived. Have arrived. And we will see a lot of people start being transfigured in our time. Very soon you see it. Okay, it's in Zechariah 12. It's in Zechariah 12. When he say he is the least among them will be like King David. And some will be like the angels. Amen? But when you look, Zechariah 12, you go to the bottom, he said very well that he announced the transfiguration there. No, the great battle. The last day battle, he announced it there. Hallelujah. So we are going to go into the great, the last day battle, where the church is going to be persecuted. But only those, like the way Jesus can appear here, help here, appear here, here, appear. And even the Bible tells us he's waiting for what? The sons of God to be manifest. Hallelujah. So, let me read just Zechariah 12 so you can understand that. Because I didn't plan to read it, but you will see it quickly. So everything is here. Zechariah 12, okay? Verse 8 says, on that day, the Lord will defend the people of Jerusalem. The weakest among them will be like as mighty as King David. The royal descendants will be like God, like the angels of the Lord who goes before them. For that day will begin. For on that day I will begin to destroy all the nations that comes against Jerusalem. Okay? But now I'll go to verse 12. It said, all Israel will mourn, each clan by itself, and with the husband separated from the wife. The clan of David will mourn alone, as will the clan of Nathan, and the clan of Levi, and the clan of Shimon. Each of the surviving, it says surviving, clan from Judah will mourn separately, and with the husband separate from the wife. That means what? When people are taking their time right now to go to places or separate from their wife or husband, praying, and in verse 10, he say, I will pour out my spirit of grace and prayer. In King James, he said, my spirit of prayer and supplication. That is the morning, the and he said, what? You pray with a groaning. Okay, when the things happen, this is the time that Israel say, hey. And you see, all the clan will start going to go and pray as well in order to reach this level. Hallelujah. So, it is important that we understand this thing, that this time is coming. As this time is coming, right now we are okay. And that's why even I'm saying that we should pray very well, because I remember I told you here that on the 17th September coming, 9th of September coming, that actually we're supposed to be in a war. But God changed that because of the election of Trump. But right now, still we can hear the rumor about with what is going on with North Korea. Okay? That thing, you see, North Korea is not Syria, it's not Iraq. They have nuclear weapon. So when you attack them, what they do is something else. So, but I'm glad that God did it, because Trump, he listened to prophet before he takes decisions. Amen? So we have to pray for him so nothing will happen. Amen? But now, these 7 years that are ahead of us, because Trump is going to be there for 8 years, 7 years are ahead of us, we have to pray for the church to prepare, to equip the church for a lot of people to be raised in this level we are talking about. Then when he starts, so as you don't look down on anybody, you see value in them, you can be able to offer yourself. Psalm 103, amen? You can be able to do what? He said, your people will offer themselves willingly to participate in your battle, in the day of your power, in the splendor of holiness. Hallelujah. Let me tell you this. We have pursued a lot of things on this earth to have a lot of money. But there are greater things in heaven. So let's start putting ourselves into it, and we'll get there. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So, brothers and sisters, when you are transfigured, you'll be able to disappear. You'll be able to walk through walls. You'll be able to fly, change into anything as is needed. I know that one is not common, but God can change into anything, isn't it? Amen? That when we have been restored in the image God has created, the likeness God has created us into, you can do it. Amen? Hallelujah? So, for what is ahead of us, we need more people to reach this level and to lead and protect the church in the last day battle. Amen? So, brothers and sisters, it is important that we understand this thing and we take it on board. And we, but the first key or the first grace we all need to ask is the grace to love God truly, genuinely. Hallelujah. Because you may spend your life with somebody and you realize that it seems like I don't really love this guy, or I don't really love this guy. It's because what he was doing. Oh, do you know that sometimes some people, you have some friend, later you discover that actually is what you were doing in the life of the person, what you were giving him or offering him, that person, that's why the person was always with you. So as soon as you don't have it anymore, the person departs from you. So did that person really love you? No. So most of it, we have some people as well, we go to God for what God is doing in our life. But when things go completely wrong, that's when we see the story of Job. Job proved that he lost God. Hallelujah. So that's why I'm saying the first key, the first gift everybody must ask, Father, I want to love you. Help me to love you genuinely. Amen. Hallelujah. Okay, God bless you.
What I saw was a spirit going around the church, touching people and turning them into white, like completely white. And he would go from row to row, so he'll go around and touch one person and then move on to the next.
Okay, good. But now you come and tell me when you experienced your transfiguration, what happened?
So I was worshiping and all of a sudden the glory appeared before me, and Father God was speaking to me. He said a lot of things to me, and the last thing that he said was, come up higher. At that time, I didn't understand what he was talking about. Mm-hmm. But then, when the glory disappeared, I was standing somewhere here, and then the glory just carried me. There were so many people there, but I just flew and dropped somewhere there. I didn't know what was happening still. So when I finished, I stood up, and then the service was where this happened in Florida.
Yeah.
And so I was standing outside, and then one guy came, and then he said to me, I saw you flying like an angel. And I'm like, really? And then as we were talking, then he covered his face. And then so I asked him what was happening. And he says, my face is radiating with light so much that he cannot look at me. So I was like, wow. And then now the service was finished, and as soon as everybody comes out, as soon as they see me where I was standing, they start, as soon as they come out, and then they turn, they see it was so strong. As soon as they turn, then everybody was started coming towards me. Then I started explaining to them that the encounter that I've had with the presence of God.
Hallelujah.
So my experience with Transfiguration was, I was on stage and there was a bunch of people, they were looking up, but they weren't looking at me. It was like I was a white, it was just pure, pure white, and it was almost like they could see God or Jesus through me. And so I can't really explain it. I wasn't present, but it was just my character wasn't there. It was like Jesus' character, it's God's character. And then they were looking up, and they wanted to be closer to God. They wanted that glory. They wanted to be near God. So that's my experience.
Okay. Yeah. Hallelujah. Amen. You see, we have more we can say. I can even call people more. Amen. But to tell you that, there's something new God wants to do. That's why he's releasing this type of teaching. So we must take it seriously and pursue it. And God will give us. Hallelujah. Pursue it and God will give us. And when you reach that level, nothing, I'm telling you, nothing can threaten you. Nothing. Amen. And me personally, what God told me, I asked him, he said, you want to get 21 people in this ministry transfigured. 21. I don't know who, maybe you, I don't know. But when I say you, depend if you want it and you seek it, you have it. Hallelujah. So please believe God for this and you see his glory. Amen. Believe God for this and you see his glory. It is possible. But now, why people experience it? Me and myself, I have been transfigured before. When I was transfigured, I felt like, you see when you see balloon, when they blow balloon, when you see, so I felt, I don't say light or empty, to the point that, because first of all, he showed me the sons of God. When he shows me the sons of God, I saw them, they were completely white inside, but only the skin as were upon their body. So And he told me that scientifically they say that what is not lighter than the air cannot fly. So you understand that you have to be light in order to be raptured, because at the rapture you have to go like this. So when you are like a balloon, the air can take you, you can go up. So that's the regenerated body. Okay? So the day me, I just look at myself and say, what is this? You know that you feel nothing. You weigh nothing, that's the word. You weigh nothing. But I taste it to tell me that, hey, this is why I'm calling you. So you have to pursue it. Hallelujah. We have to pursue it. And I thank God that it's not me just giving these experiences, whatever, giving my destiny, but it's more people. So God wants to do it for us. We are getting into another dimension. Because say what? The body of the age to come, in order to live in the age to come. In that age we are going into, okay, in that age we are going into, if you don't have this new body, you can't live in that age. Hallelujah. So please, God is good, wonderful. Pray and seek him. Honestly, blame, I don't know. Ask him. This one, we are going to do it. We put it on the, what do you call it? On the internet. Watch it over and over. And everything that is in, start seeking it, praying with it. Seeking it, praying with it. And you see that God will help you. The way you think will change into the way God thinks. The way God see everybody, anybody. God is saying, how can I help this one to become better? My intention upon him. So when you start thinking like that, you reach the most holy. Then he can share things with you for you. Like he shared with Moses about the people of Israel. What Moses said? No, don't destroy them. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Okay, God bless you. So we are going to pray God.